Hey everybody, welcome back. In this video, we're going to dive into the first model we learn in economics, the production possibilities curve. Be sure to hit that like button and subscribe as you enjoy that funky music. All right, so we do a lot of graphing and modeling in economics.
Come on, work it! Oh yeah, own it!
No, not that kind of modeling. God, no. We like to draw graphs that are simplified models of human behavior and economies. And the very first one is known as the production possibilities curve, or the PPC. And we use this in both micro and macroeconomics, so it has applications in both courses. The idea behind the PPC is that we're seeing what is possible for an economy to produce, just like the name implies. And good news, one of the simplifying assumptions we're going to make for this model is that we can only produce two goods. In this case, we'll say capital goods and consumer goods. So we'll put capital goods on our vertical or y-axis and consumer goods on the horizontal or x-axis. And for this version of the PPC, we have a downward sloping line going from one axis to the other. This curve represents the outer limit of what is currently possible for the economy or the person to produce. Notice that they can produce at a maximum 100 capital goods or 200 consumer goods. Here's where some of the concepts from the first video are going to come back into play. Remember scarcity, opportunity cost, trade-offs? They're all here on this model. Let's start with scarcity. Because of the limited nature of resources, it isn't possible to produce an infinite amount of capital and consumer goods, so choices have to be made. If this economy decides to maximize its production of capital goods, it can produce 100 of them. But notice that they'll be producing zero consumer goods. At the other extreme, they can use all their resources to produce 200 consumer goods, but then they'll have zero capital goods. Or they can produce some combination in between, like 50 capital goods and 100 consumer goods. And that's essentially the idea of trade-offs, isn't it? If they're operating on the PPC and want to produce more consumer goods, the only way to do that is to produce fewer capital goods. And if they want to produce more capital goods, then guess what? They'll have to produce fewer consumer goods. Now let's be even more specific. Suppose that we move from point A to point B. We gain 100 consumer goods. We had 50, and now we have 150, right? Well, what's the opportunity cost? In other words, what did we give up? We were making 75 capital goods, and now we're only making 25. So the opportunity cost of moving from A to B is 50 capital goods. So that's one thing the PPC does for us. But it also displays the concepts of efficiency, underutilized resources, as well as economic growth or contraction. I'm going to define efficiency as society getting the most it can out of its scarce resources. On the PPC, any point along the PPC is a point of efficiency, since it isn't possible to make more of one good without giving up some of the other. Now, notice that we're not making any judgments about what combination of capital and consumer goods we think should be produced, but rather all we're saying is simply what it is possible to currently produce. If our economy is operating anywhere inside of the PPC, this means it has underutilized resources, and this is inefficient. Look at point C. It's possible for them to produce more of both capital and consumer goods. This means that there are resources available that are not being used for one reason or another. On the other hand, any point outside the PPC is not currently a possible combination of goods that can be produced. But it is possible that that combination can be produced in the future as a result of economic growth. Economic growth is the result of an increase in our factors of production. So if land, labor, capital increases, the possibilities of what can be produced in our economy will also increase. This means more natural resources, more machinery, better tools, better technology, a better educated workforce will all cause our PPC to shift outward to the right, meaning that those combinations that aren't currently possible can become possible in the future. Additionally, increases in technology and productivity cause economic growth. Productivity refers to how much a worker can produce. So if workers are better educated or have more access to better technology and machinery, then those workers will be more productive. On the other hand, it's possible that the PPC could shift inward if there was a significant decrease in one or more of our factors of production. For example, if a war or disaster led to widespread destruction of a natural resource or loss of life, well, we wouldn't be able to produce as much, and this would cause a contraction of the economy, shifting the PPC inward to the left. The last thing I want to share with you is that the shape of the PPC matters. So far, I've shown you a linear or downward sloping PPC, but the PPC can also be concave, bowed outward, or convex, bowed inward. Everything that we've done to this point is true regardless of the shape of the PPC. So I just want you to know that everything about scarcity, opportunity cost, and economic growth, they can be done on any of these PPC shapes. What determines the shape of the PPC is whether opportunity costs are constant, increasing, or decreasing. So let's start with our first PPC. Our linear PPC represents constant opportunity costs. Notice that when we go from A to B, our opportunity cost is 25 capital goods. When we go from B to C, it's still 25 capital goods. And when we go from C to D, well, yeah, you guessed it, 25 capital goods. On the other hand, notice what happens on our concave or bowed outward PPC. This PPC represents increasing opportunity cost. From A to B, the opportunity cost is 10 capital goods. From B to C, though, it's 15 capital goods. And if we go from C to D, it's even higher, 50 capital goods. So what's happening here? Well, the resources that are really useful for making one good might not be very useful for making the other. Let's make this computers and pizza, and I think you'll see what I mean. At point A, we're making only computers, so all workers are making computers. Now, let's say we decide that we also want to produce some pizza. Now, you'd probably pick your very best pizza chefs, wouldn't you? And you'd switch them over from computer to pizza production. So when we move from point A to point B, we have a large increase in the amount of pizza produced and a relatively small loss in computers. But what if we go from point C to D? True, we make even more pizza, but notice that the gain is pretty small and the opportunity cost was relatively large number of computers. Well, why is that? When we were at point C, you probably had your very best engineers making computers, and they were really good at it. Now, you move them off computer production, and there's going to be a large drop-off or a large cost in the loss of computers, with a comparatively small gain in pizza production. That's increasing opportunity costs. There is a third possibility, one that's probably the least common in the real world and on the AP exam as well, and that's decreasing opportunity costs. So we have a convex or bowed inward PPC. This is literally the opposite of the previous one. The more consumer goods we produce, the fewer capital goods we have to give up. Now, while this is possible, it's extremely rare. And honestly, to explain the logic behind it, we need to go into more detail about other concepts that we haven't learned yet. So for now, you'll be fine just understanding what this graph would look like and knowing that it involves a reduction in opportunity cost as more of a good is produced. Okay, take a deep breath. You made it. I know there was a lot there, but until next time, this has been a La Money production. Thanks again for watching this video, and make sure to like it if you didn't already. Be sure to check out the description for links to the answers to these practice questions and some of the great study aids I have for you, like economics in 250 words. I promise you'll love it. See you next time.